We're going to have Eldee, last year's banquet speaker, has done a number of presentations, do two things for us. He's going to present applications on Amiga OS 4, and he's also going to give us a preview into the Amiga OS 4.1 final edition. This will be the last update before Amiga 4.2. It's always nice to have deadlines. So now the Amiga OS 4 development team has the deadline because they're not allowed to release any more updates. Because they said it was final, they have to stick to it. So without further ado, we're going to hand this over to Eldee, who's going to walk us through. And we also have Steve to present as well. So gentlemen, take it over.
Hello. Is it working? Hello. There we go. Thank you. I don't know where I should stand. I'll just sit here for now. How's that?
I'll just sit here.
Here's the logo. So, yesterday I had announced, I have an error to correct. Yesterday I announced that you require Amiga OS 4.1, a 4.1 license to purchase 4.1 Final Edition. I was wrong. That was my mistake. So the real good news is you do not need any previous 4.1 license to buy Final Edition, or 4.0 for that matter. You can just buy it. 30 euros, it's yours. So basically, that effectively means the price of Amiga OS is now 40 euros.
30.
There, I'm making mistakes again. Sorry. Anyway, for the official written news, you can now go to, as of this morning, Hyperion Entertainment's website and see it in black and white text. So you don't have to listen to me anymore. How's that? Excuse me?
If you had a 4.0 system, you could just buy 4.1.
Yeah, if you had a 4.0 system, just buy 4.1 for 30 euros or whatever it's going to be in America. And away you go. You're done. How's that, Dave? Good deal. So I just wanted to correct that. That was my mistake. Not Hyperion's mistake, it's just my personal. Sorry. It's still a very good idea to register your serial numbers, though. Without it, you can't.
You didn't be like that.
Because if you don't, you can't get Amy Update to work. Amy Update will not work without a valid serial number. So, there you go. And without further ado, Eldee.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. Let's make sure the audio is working. Okay, not too bad. So I'll try that again. Good morning, everyone. My name is Eldee Stevens. I'm representing intuitionbase.com, which is a site that was put together by a lot of wonderful Amigans in the UK. Most people here are familiar with it, but if you're not, it's a wonderful site to go to double check and make certain if you have particular classic applications, whether or not it works on OS 4. There's lots of tips and tricks for your Amiga 1 systems there. There's some feature articles on setting up things like wireless and reviews and that sort of thing. So please, by all means, do check it out if you haven't before. I joined I joined the Amiga 1 X5000 beta testing program some months ago, and in addition to enjoying playing around with my new Cyrus board and helping debug that, I've also had the privilege of testing what has turned into Amiga OS 4.1 Final Edition. This is not, believe it or not, a slapdash release. This is something that has been in the works now for some time. The software that you're going to receive with this release is not the work of developers over the past few weeks or a few months, but for some years. There are over 150 separate components of the operating system that have seen new features added, performance improvements, bug fixes. So many of the things that we've been frustrated with, many of the features that we've asked for, they've been there waiting for OS 4.2. And Hyperion Management was kind enough to go ahead and decide, given that the schedule, some of the core components of 4.2 were slipping out, to go ahead and get this software in the hands of Amigans as quickly as possible. And I'm going to walk through some of those today for those of you who are here at Amiwest. I don't think we're streaming. We're not streaming live, are we?
Yes, we are.
We are still streaming?
No,
we're not streaming.
Okay.
Oh, we're not.
It broke.
Oh,
the PC just came out.
Okay. All right. Well, in that case, those people on IRC.
It couldn't handle the good news.
So one of the nice things is for those of us who've been kind of struggling with update after update after update for what, 5-6 years now. Finally, we get a fresh new ISO, press CD, pop it in the machine, boot it up as a live CD, just like before. You also have, of course, a professional installer that comes with it. There's lots of new contributions, by the way, to be installed as extras. It's a very nice, professionally put together package. And among some of the features that you're going to enjoy are as follows. I would say probably the biggest set of improvements in the operating system are actually ones you're not going to physically see, but you're going to sort of feel. The kernel has been updated, for example, for support for beyond 2 gigabytes of storage. Now, for a variety of technical reasons, and you don't really want to transition to a 64-bit OS, not only because of the massive work that's involved in doing that, but also because all of your applications, well, most of them, will no longer work. What this allows is this allows developers to go ahead and access beyond that 2 gigabyte barrier storage in what are called, what, XMEM objects?
Extended memory objects.
And these are tremendously useful for, say, image manipulation programs. A lot of us are starting to work with very high resolution image files, very, very large image files. We even have some professional photographers here, so they'll know what I'm talking about. That's one great application of this technology. Another one might be, for example, modifying the RAM handler in the operating system itself so that your RAM disk can take advantage of all the storage that you have. It would be lovely to have this extra 8 gigabytes RAM disk sitting there that you could copy to. And I can imagine that could also include things like your RAD device. So that's another possible example. So the support is there for that in the kernel. There have also been other performance improvements in the kernel. There have been a lot of stability improvements in the kernel. There have been updates to our default C library, new lib from...
I would just...
Yeah.
Just one more thing about the extended memory.
Mm-hmm.
We are actually working on... We have a blog entry on the developer blog mm-hmm. about it already. So if you want to know a little more guts and details, we have a blog entry on the developer blog right now.
Yep. And the nice thing also is shortly after shipping final edition, developers will have an updated SDK, I think it's being put together as we speak.
Yes, SDK is on the way.
Right, and that'll include code examples, tons of documentation, as is always, nicely put together. So for you developers out there, we're all hoping that you all take advantage of this very nice feature. Oh, by the way, also, the pthreads library has been updated with some stability improvements and bug fixes there as well. That's very important. Not necessarily, you're not going to see it immediately, but for applications that use it heavily, like Timberwolf, you're going to find enhanced stability with those changes. Another major, major piece of work that was done under the covers is the graphics library. The graphics subsystem of the operating system has been fragmented for, well, really, ever since the introduction of RGG, I would say that.
At least 1996.
Right. So now, graphics library has incorporated almost all the components of the graphics subsystem. So Picasso 96 is at last gone. RPG library has been subsumed into graphics library. Layers library has been subsumed into graphics.library. And at long last, we have a native graphics system that is precisely what those who came up with the idea of RPG in the first place would have wanted. So this has been a tremendous amount of work by Steve Solie and Renee Olson and others. And it's not just the fact that the performance has been improved slightly. It's not just that the stability is there. It's introduced new features that make new applications possible. A great example is Mr. Broad here, who did his work on personal paint. That takes advantage of some new features in graphics library. He even found some bugs that got fixed as well. And the nice thing about this is, from a user perspective, forget all the code elegance stuff, just the raw performance of all the changes when you start aggregating them together is huge. What I'm going to show you now, you all might be familiar with the GraphicsBench 2D benchmark program from Hans de Reuter. Someone, accidentally, but I'm glad they did, went ahead and tested a Radeon, I can't read it from here, I think it's a 6900 series card. My eyesight's not that good, but what I'm going to do is I'm going to scroll down to the bottom. I want to show you this number here. Bam! Look at that. 8,326. That is a massive improvement in performance. And this is not just with 2D graphics. The changes enable things like the new Radeon HD driver. It enables things like video composition. And it's not just the 2D side of things. Some developers, including Carl Churchill and others, have also worked on MiniGL and Warp 3D. So all your Warp 3D drivers for your R200 cards, for media, Voodoo, and so forth. And what I'm going to do now, actually, I'm going to show you the difference here, just real quick. It's not the best, demo in the world, but it'll do. I still like to play first-person shooter games, and I actually play a lot of Quake 2 with various mods. I can't read that from here. There we go. Is that Quake 2?
Yeah.
Okay.
So. From here too.
Okay. So I think. All right. I apologize for the smallness. That has to do more with the projector than the machine. But what I'm going to do now is I'm going to do a quick time demo here. You probably won't be able to see it, but we're going to give it a shot anyway. Now, this Pegasus 2 is unclocked. It is not a particularly performant machine because I've got a lot of IDE to SATA converters and there's a bunch of performance bottlenecks. And my graphics card is pretty slow. So when I do the time demo, on the first level, I get, with current Amiga OS 4.1 Update 6, 24 frames per second. Watch what happens now. We're going to let this go for a little bit. Want to cover the full thing? Yeah, get some. All right, there we go. Bam! Now, I can't read it from here, but what we got over in the corner in a second was 49. It's even better. More than double. Now, I don't want you all to think that this means that 3D performance is going to double everywhere, but come on. 24 to 49 frames per second, that is a massive improvement. Massive improvement on the 2D side, massive improvement on the 3D side, new features, better stability. It's absolutely tremendous, and you all are going to enjoy it in more ways than one. So there's that. I should also point out that there were a ton of bug fixes on this side, particularly over in MiniGL as well. I know that some developers, I'm trying to remember the chap that worked for Cherry Darling. I can't remember. You all have probably played some of their games, Voxel Noid, Voxel Bird. He was having some difficulty with MiniGL and so forth. I'm hoping that when this release gets out there, he'll be able to do what he wanted to do in the first place without having to write directly to Warp 3D. But it's pretty cool. So a huge thanks to everybody who worked on the graphics subsystem. Another area that's got an awful lot of work was intuition and all of your Boopsy classes. Now, this is not something that you're necessarily going to see, but developers will. There's been performance improvements, yes, a lot of bug fixes. I'm trying to remember, Massimo and Simon, I think, were the fellows who worked on this. There, very, very, very rarely will a user encounter some of the problems with these gadgets, but you may have seen occasional graphics corruption or things of that nature, but these things have all been fixed, and I'm looking here, and there are new features, better performance on everything. Almost every gadget, choosers, click tabs, fillers, the color tool, the integer gadget, scrolling gadget, strings, windows, and so forth. And that has an aggregate effect of making your whole machine that much more stable. And by the way, can I just point out, as a user, I've used AROS, Morphic OS, Amiga OS 4.1, Update 6, 3.9, and let's be honest, without memory protection, we get the occasional freeze. We get the occasional crash on all of them. I can say, hand on heart, that this is by far the most stable experience I have had on an Amiga in 5 years. I'm able to run day after day after day, games, internet browsing, productivity applications, nothing. And that is a massive, massive improvement. So between the kernel, intuition changes, graphics changes, all those bug fixes really come together quite nicely. I'm actually going to show you all some user features here in a minute, but I wanted to talk about some more other things. DOS has changed quite a bit as well under the covers. We've got a new library, diskio.library. Do you know what that does? Do you want to talk about that a little bit?
Yeah,
Well, that's a brand new component, and it handles a centralized disk caching for file systems. Before, you would have to have your own cache on every file system you wrote. So, for example, NTFS, we added the file system for that, and it was abysmally slow until we added a cache, and then that sped it up. Right? So this is just a centralized cache instead of each one doing its own thing. And that's the basic gist of it.
And it's just another example of some of the features that have been added on the DOS subsystem to make life a lot easier for people who are porting file systems over to the operating system. Collins created a whole new API for that purpose and has really cleaned things up. You don't have to deal with DOS packets anymore. IDE tool has been updated. Some of the file systems have been updated, like Smart SFS. The RAM handler's got bug fixes and actually a pretty big performance improvement. There's a great kickstart module provided by Mr. Wyatt here to read from your compact flash cards on your X1000, which is quite nice. And also I've noticed, and I think you did this actually, there's performance improvements on the IDE drivers as well. I think it now currently defaults to the best available DMA mode without having to monkey around with firmware variables.
That actually has been there for a while.
Has it?
Yes.
Has it been an update 6? I just noticed it with FE.
No, that feature's been there for a while.
Okay, well, I take that
update
back.
4 or something. It's not
really?
New. Yeah.
All right, well, I take
but
that back.
I did add it for Cyrus, X5000.
Okay.
So the X5000 now defaults to DMA mode, which is helpful.
And last, before we start digging into some GUI changes, I want to just talk about file systems because we were talking about it. There have been a lot of changes to file system stock by Frederick Wickstrom. And we now have support, in addition to NTFS, we are going to have support for ext2 and ext3 file systems for Linux, which is terrific, and enhanced support for different variations on the FAT file system from PCs. There's going to be a file system, I don't know if it's made the cut, if it hasn't, it'll be probably released shortly thereafter, for support for HFS extended file systems on your Mac, from your Mac platform. There's also a third-party file system support, box.net cloud storage. So let's just kind of sum this up, right? We were, less than a year ago, in a situation where our compatibility at file system level was basically Amiga file systems and FAT. That's it. Now you have the ability to interoperate with file systems from modern Windows machines, modern Macs, modern Linux boxes, and we can have the ability to interact with a commercial cloud storage system. So I think that's tremendous. Not to mention, of course, there have also been updates to mass storage, which is a component of the USB subsystem, for better performance, better stability. Do you want to talk about anything else file system related?
No, that covers it for now.
All right, so let's start digging into some of the actual user changes at the GUI level. The big one, the one everyone's been waiting for, Tony's magnificent new shell. And it's not just skin deep, folks. Ooh. Yeah, so it's... it is tabbed, of course, and of course that means that you can have lots and lots and lots of shells if you like. Which is very nice. The auto-completion features are quite cool. So if I take a look here and let's see where I'm on the sys disk. Okay, so let me go and do L. If I do type L and tab, I can have it inline if I like. Or, here's something quite nice, you can go to the preferences tool, which comes with our shell, and we can change how we do auto-completion. You can have a pop-up menu if you like. You can have it inline if you like. You can even turn it off if you don't like the idea of auto-completion. You can set the colors to whatever you like. You can have some nice color schemes here. We've got the ANSI colors, for example. Let's use that for a second here. I'm going to clear that. And did that not work? I missed text? Okay. So what I'll do now, get color highlighting. Yes, check it out. Very nice. And for all you Unix geeks out there, I know that I spend most of my time connected to my Linux and Solaris boxes constantly with the shell, with Secure Shell. And the default console device that we've had for so long, you get all sorts of problems with escape characters and you can't navigate. Finally, we have really great compatibility for other terminal types in the shell. You can. We've also got some nice online help here to find out all the new features which are included. So it's well documented. It's incredibly stable. You get your scrolling. You can set. Can you capture logs with this as well? So you can pipe stuff out to a text file as well, which is terrific. Tony's been working on this for years. I don't think there's any bugs left possible to find at this point. So it's a huge accomplishment, and everyone is going to enjoy this. I know it has for me because I'm a shell-heavy user. Oh, and that reminds me, actually, I forgot to tell you all. There's a whole bunch of utilities in your C drawer, so command line tools, that have new arguments and new options. So when you get FE and install it, because I'm sure all of us will, look through the help documentation. You're going to find all sorts of great stuff. I'm thinking of guys who do a lot of shell scripting, like Severin and so forth online. There's a bunch of command line tools that have got new features that are going to make life easier for people who are doing things like parsing through files and file manipulation and so forth. So just take a look at help on copy. I can't read that. But anyway, I'll let you all go do that. That was a bad color choice on my part. So there it is. That's the new shell that we've all been waiting for. Fantastic. There have been updates also on the workbench side. Some minor tools, but really help make the difference. One of the things that people have been asking for a long time is image previews within the workbench itself. And we have that now. It's built into the operating system. You can actually go to Workbench Preferences to set this up. Over in, is that Workbench Preferences?
It is.
There's a Previews tab here where you can set up all you like. Everything's cached, so everything is really, really quite quick. So for example, I turned it on in my screenshots drawer here the other day, and where is it here? Bam, instant. And it gives you information on the files themselves, including their sizes. And this actually leads me to another nice new feature that I didn't mention before, which is part of data types. Data types have been worked on quite a bit as well. The performance improvements are substantial. A lot of the data types now have write support, which we didn't have before. Just double click on this JPEG, boom, instant, just like that. So really terrific. There's that. You can set up previews if you, in any way you like as far as size limitations. If you don't want previews, you don't have to turn it on. You can turn it on a per drawer basis, per disk basis. You can force it on one area or not. You can have it inherit the preference of the parent object. So for example, if you want, you can just turn it on at the disk level where all your images are, and you don't have to set it up on a per drawer basis or anything like that. So that's quite nice. We also have on the graphics department, I don't know if you noticed this when I was doing this, you'll see on the context menus commodity, we have some nice color icon support here. And by the way, context menus, the default setup is rather more intelligent than it used to be. So for example, if you click on an icon, you get, let me just go here, and inside a disk or space, you'll see there's a new submenu, and that changes based on the context, whether you're on your workbench, whether you're inside a disk, a drawer, whether you're looking at a file. There's also better support for extracting from archives. Oh, and that also reminds me. Oh, there you are then. So if we go and take a look, one of the things that changes unarc, you'll see down here at the bottom, this guy right here, pattern matching. Now, I have archives that I bring over from my Linux machine a lot, and there are even archives, AmiNet, OS4 Depot, LFJ files, just tons of files, right? The archive contains 1,000 different files, and you may want maybe 80 of them. But the last thing you want to do is click on none and then go through and click those 80 out of 1,000. It takes forever. Well, now you can select or deselect based on a particular regular expression, or DOS expression, rather. I shouldn't say regular expression. That's a different thing. So you have that ability in UnArc. And by the way, if you take the updated UnArc and you combine it with some of the some of the decoders, the XPK decoders, have been worked on by Frederick, not as part of the operating system, but are being posted for everybody. Decompression now is quite a bit faster. A lot of this stuff has been cleaned up, and those components you can get, I think, on AmiNet or OS4 Depot to make use in conjunction with UnArc. There are additional features inside of Workbench Press. I can't walk through all of them. I'll let you all discover them when you install FE. we've got a lot more options than we used to for customability. Another option here that's kind of cool is, and this may, maybe this has already been out there and I'm just now noticing it, so Steve, correct me if I'm wrong, but I'm fairly certain we didn't used to be able to set up a background image on a per screen basis.
We did do?
Yeah. So that's not a new feature. Right, so I'm glad this isn't being streamed. I'd look like an idiot. All right, well, I just discovered it, and it's great. So there you go.
Wait a minute, Each individual window can have its own background? Is that what you're saying?
No, on a per-screen basis. On a per-screen basis.
I thought it was new. I'm like, wait a minute.
No. Some of the other nice little things. We have this little commodity called Auto Info. If you just put your pointer over something like this drawer and wait a second, you'll get, if it's working, yes, there it is. You'll get a little gadget that pops up that tells you what it is, what type it is, how large it is, and the files inside it, the last modified date, that sort of thing. Some of you all may not like that. It's not a very Amiga-ish feature per se, but for those of us who grew up on things like Macs and Windows machines, it's actually quite useful. So. That's a new commodity there in the workbench space. I'm kind of running out of time. Actually, I'm gone over here a little bit, so let me try and wrap this up if I can. There's a bunch of other things, too. We've got an updated Python subsystem, and that's not a small change, but it's an important one. We've also got better support for MIDI out of the box. There's an updated Kandy library that's coming. One of the contributions from Lyle is Timmy. So that's included as a contribution, so you've got better MIDI support out of the box. You can refer to the press release from Hyperion that they posted this morning for some more details that I haven't talked to. One of the things, of course, that you get is you get some new backdrops, you get some updated icons, of course, from Martin Mason Meritz, which is, did I pronounce that correctly? May not have done. But you'll notice this throughout the operating system in different places. For example, just slightly altered coloration. So that printer icon now looks quite lovely. It's black rather than beige as it used to be, and so forth. So this is sort of a sneak preview of some of the updated icons that may or may not be coming with OS 4.2. So that's nice.
Well, with 4.2, we're going to a new icon scheme.
Wait.
Actually.
Oh, totally new?
Totally new.
Oh, I haven't seen these yet. Then,
no.
I? Oh, okay. Oh,
no,
cool.
You're not on the list.
I'm about to give up. All right. But so, to summarize all this up, guys, what we're talking about is a release of 4.1 that is more performant than ever on the graphics side, 2D and 3D. More performant with the GUI. More performant at the base level with the kernel and the C library, speeding everything up. It is far more stable. It has many new features. And the best part about it is 30 euro. That's it. And that, by the way, includes VAT. So for those of us Americans who are cheap and feeling, oh, the exchange rate, we're getting screwed. Actually, no, because when you subtract VAT from Germany to here, it comes out to just over $30 US. So actually, it's very, very cheap. And what's especially brilliant about all this is, you don't even have to have an Amiga 1 system just yet because of, and this is probably not something that I should be saying, but you've got WinUAE now. That means for all those classic guys out there who have wanted to try OS 4 for so long without having to spend a fortune, they can now try it out for 30 euro. Absolutely fantastic. The cost of the operating system has been dropped down to a third of what it was. So, a massive amount of work has gone into this. I think you're going to love it. It's a great price. It's brilliant. So that's really all there is to say. And at this point, I'm going to open it up to questions for Mr. Solie here.
I'm running a lot better.
I can't seriously put it on the internet.
Just a second. Honestly, guys, I can't tell you how exciting it is to not be embarrassed in front of my friends playing 3D games. That alone is worth the money. Sorry, I just had to put that in.
That was perfect. That was awesome. What are you doing with the icons now? What are you taking the icons?
Well, the icon default size is changing to something very, very large. And a totally new look to it as well.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
We like to do that every major release, is change the look and feel a little bit. Yeah.
24-bit workbench?
24-bit work? It already is.
It is.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's 32 bits. It's even higher.
Let me see.
You want 64?
Yeah. 4K. 1024.
Some of the new file systems are writable. Some are read-only. It really depends on which one. Yeah. Yeah. There's a mix usually. File systems are very tricky. So.
I've got a question for
multi-user is not supported, no. No. There's no multi-user on Amiga OS. No. Nope.
It's a personal
computer. Yeah. It's for you,
TJ. TJ has a question for LD.
Yeah, on Win UAE. To date, it's been classic that you've had to purchase.
That's correct.
What version would we be buying? Then?
You'll be buying Final Edition.
That's
a good point. I didn't mention that. Final Edition is for everybody, guys. Every machine that is currently supported, you get it now. Or I also forgot to mention on the SAMs, you get some better DMA support over there, too. So for you SAM guys, you're getting some even better performance than some of the rest of us. So is that right?
440, 460.
440, 460?
Yeah.
There's not different CDs for...
There are different CDs for each platform as before, that's true.
Right, so which one would we buy then?
You'd buy the classic.
The classic.
Yes, so, right, because when UAE is emulating a Cyberstorm, plugged into, well, you should set it up as a 4000 with a Cyberstorm.
Okay.
Right. By the way, for those of you who are more eagle-eyed than others about the icons and so forth, you might have found on the wiki some examples. I don't know that these are the ones that they're going to finalize on, but as far as size is concerned, yeah, we're going high resolution, baby. You better believe it. Look at this. Look at this. It's huge. So yeah, I don't know that this is the style.
Those are thumbnails. Click on them. Go to the full size.
Oh, God. I don't know necessarily that this is the final side they're going to adopt for 4.2, but I would like to point out that whatever it is that they decide to do, the amount of work and thought that is put into the GUI by the artists that contribute to the operating system is massive, to make certain that things are consistent and as beautiful and also useful in giving you useful feedback on what they do. So, yeah. Right. Any more questions for Dr. Solie here? All right, well, if there are no more questions, I hope you all have enjoyed this exclusive sneak preview. You might also get some more information from the press release, as well as picking up issue 111 of Amiga Future. And this is going to be out pretty soon, guys. You're going to love it. So I hope you enjoyed as much as I have.